In 2016, Persona 5 exploded on PlayStation 3 in such a way that you might think the colour red had never existed before. In its insatiable visual language and its defiance of the quotidian standards of Japanese role-playing games, there was hope the era of flicking through boring menus was over. If nothing else, it certainly fired a shot across the bow of its competitors. A spin-off of the popular Megami Tensei series, Persona isn't completely distinct from most JRPGs. Its turn-based combat between teams of characters, supplemented by magic, monsters, and items, place it firmly within the genre. Pokemon meets Final Fantasy. Indeed, its first two volumes could be mistaken for Square Enix's flagship franchise, so similar was the visual presentation of the games. What set Persona apart at the beginning was its narratives. Persona employed the fundamentals of Jungian and Freudian psychology to address the idea of the individual versus the collective. At a time when most games in the genre centered on arbitrary dungeon crawling and pseudo-medieval worlds, Persona's very modern take felt refreshingly original. It was with the third installment of the series that something clicked. As gaming moved into a new generation, what we've come to know as Persona's unique style began to emerge. It wasn't polished, but already the presentation was more dynamic and intuitive to the game's themes. Lead interface designer Masayoshi Suto began to push the limits of what gaming UI was capable of. He set about implementing a system that felt tactile and significant, making the usual rote act of JRPG combat feel alive and exciting. This development continues through Persona 4, culminating in Persona 5. With Suto taking over as art director, the game's youth in revolt narrative becomes integral to its visual direction. Persona 5 is a moving canvas, built upon the cutout handmade style so synonymous with early punk. It oozes with what Kathy McCarthy describes as unfuckwithable coolness, so singular in every asset of its being that it's nearly impossible for other games to compete. The many influences behind the narrative, music, and art direction catapult into one another in an energetic, joyful explosion. There are no other menus like the magazine clipped letters that trickle within Persona 5s. There are no battle interruptions that roll out like a frenetic, pristinely illustrated manga panel. Every aspect of the game seems to weep with style and zest. It is a composition constantly on the move. While some argue that video games are not art, Persona 5 sets out to prove without any doubt that they are wrong. The result is that every single screen, from animation to menuing, combat to character movement, becomes a painting. Western players will most readily conflate Persona 5's visuals with the punk subculture of the 1970s. The familiar cutout typography and vibrant colours were certainly a part of punk's aesthetic zenith, but we're also seeing a refraction of the 50-year-old movement through the prism of its Japanese development. When punk hit Japan, it did so in a post-war and post-Todai country. Counterculture had become a major part of Japanese life. We may have settled into an apathetic state in the West, one that has seen punk shambling amid the lingering scent of big business and a heap of rotten imitators as it falls into irrelevancy, but in Japan, punk endured. Though inspired by the West, its rapid growth didn't see it burn out as in Europe and the US. Rather, fueled by memories of American occupation and the induction of techno-driven collectivism, it evolved into something more distinct. This diffusion is nothing new. For almost two centuries, East and West have shared ideals at odds with our stereotypical regard for Japan as the Far East. And what followed was noise, a movement that intensified the ideals of punk into an assault full of writhing, raw, and unpredictable sound that was shockingly fresh. It grew from the relict nature of punk in a curious way, however. At once the epitome of DIY art culture incited by punk, yet, thanks to its wide array of instruments, also influenced by a range of musical styles. This paradoxical relationship was solidified into what is sometimes called Japanoise, a style that challenges the representations of musical history, that does not settle in a distinct place or group of people, and whose fragmented mediation makes it difficult to depict its ethnographic terrain. Initially, noise relied on the chaotic anarchy of sound so familiar in punk, to the point that the music was often void of melody, harmony, and rhythm. However, noise as we know it today has evolved to include new influences, including jazz and new wave, and moved beyond intensity for intensity's sake. Among its pioneers, Shonen Knife, Melt Banana, and Amoide Hatoba represent a stylistic freeze frame to which many continue to reference. For better or worse, the result is that noise has diffused beyond its underground origins and into the international music scene, growing in a zealously undefined way. In the 21st century, noise groups adorn the covers of music magazines and attract sellout audiences. Many of its influences, in particular punk and jazz, are some of the most politicized genres in popular music. But in a collectivistic Japan, noise wasn't conceived as festival music, but as a highly individual and emotional experience. At the heart of Persona 5 is a narrative of the individual at odds with the collective, in which Young's collective consciousness is used to corrupt the masses and the protagonists fight for the free thought and thus the collective well-being of the public. But in all the chapters of Persona 5's narratives, there is a personal undercurrent. The Phantom Thieves begin by changing the heart of an abusive, predatory teacher in their own school, his abuses ignored by his superiors for the supposed good of the institution. But even as their efforts grow to have national implications, they are still driven by individual threat. It should then resonate with players that many listeners of noise started with a design to regain control over their own perception. In an increasingly mechanized Japan, the point was to transform the industrial disruption of their daily lives into something more deliberate, to create a superior noise and to offset one noise with another. By acknowledging, confronting, and embracing their inner selves, Persona 5's protagonists do much the same. They drown out the noise of their elders, which often sermonizes the benefits of collectivism, in favor of their own judgment, all of which emerges through the visual storytelling of the game. Every palace is powered by ordinary people made drones by their belief in a greater good. Slaves to sporting success, criminal debt, artistic tutelage, normalized burnout, and societal status. In every instance, the collective is put to work for the benefit of the individual, and it is this conflict between the balance of collectivism and individualism that is so pivotal to the game's story and so integral to its influences. The protagonists of Persona 5 fight against dictatorial antagonists in the same way punk positioned itself against right-wing authoritarian ideology. And whatever noise was and has become, the movements that sprouted from punk remain what we make of them, a stylistic blank slate upon which we can present all our rebellion and desire for reform. While many of Persona 5's visuals may resemble punk cliches, in truth, like noise, they draw upon a wide range of influences, all of which could be heard in its soundtrack, experienced through its gameplay, and seen in its visual language. These are then codified into a single identity, a reflection of DIY counterculture that is so accomplished, it is difficult to see just how structured it has become. However, this hasn't compromised the intent. Indie gaming is replete with releases that hark back to the 1990s, but successful retro-inspired experiences don't actually emulate the games from which they claim influence, rather, they evoke. They show us what our rose-coloured memories have constructed through years of revision. Shovel Knight does not play like a 90s 16-bit game, it is more robust, tighter, it flows smoothly. It is at odds with the often unfair, buggy experiences we conveniently forget for the sake of nostalgia. Games that stick too rigidly to the outdated formulas and gameplay of their predecessors feel off by comparison. They fail to catch the imagination in the same way because they represent what we try to forget about the games we love. This is what Persona 5's visual identity does so well. We don't see the mess, the rough edges of DIY punk subculture. We are instead given a beautiful, ratified version. There is enough contextual understanding to make the imagery feel authentic, but modern design sensibilities allow us to see the best of a movement that was so often hidden behind frayed edges and tempers. For all its strengths, Persona 5 is not without its visual issues, in particular its consideration of accessibility. Those with ocular disabilities may struggle to track the game's fast-moving typography, and the lack of accessibility options in the game and its 2020 re-release only compound the issue. Traditional JRPG interfaces may be graphically boring, but they are also readable for the most part. Persona 5 may have benefited from at least some options to make the UI less noisy. Accessibility mistress Kelly Marine suggests that every effect which can be described as flashy should be optional. Video games are defined by their interactivity, and graphic design should not trump usability. After all, a core tenet of design is that form follows function, which doesn't have to compromise the graphical intent. Rather, Atlus could have included options to shift the alignment of text to a single axis or reduce animations, thus simplifying the tableau while also retaining fidelity to the original intent. The bustling imagery can make the game difficult to pass for some, but the typographic treatment of Persona 5's localization hasn't helped. Now, the Persona series isn't exactly a stranger to subpar localization, but the bold font used in the Japanese version of Persona 5 doesn't appear to include Latin characters, or if it does, Atlus elected to use a different, extra bold typeface that doesn't rest easily within the same space. In dialogue in particular, the condensed font can become difficult to read even for some abled players. The Japanese typography can be broadly categorized as Mincho and Gothic, both of which translate neatly into our own classifications of serif and sans serif respectively. Given the Gothic nature of the original type, a sans serif font was appropriate. It even appears to be a Japanese typeface with Latin characters, but the lack of consideration of readability in its selection is notable. It's something that reflects especially poorly in a year that saw the release of The Last of Us Part 2 and its wealth of accessibility options. Disabled voices are so often neglected in conversations about diversity, and it's important that developers work to stop lagging behind because, as time goes on, the act of hiding games behind inaccessible obstacles is increasingly moving from ignorance towards prejudice. For the more cynical among us, there is a motivation to give greater consideration to access for less able players, if only for publishers to open their markets to a wider, paying audience. Persona 5 blazes a trail of what is possible with the game's visuals. Its integration of narrative and UI demonstrate that art direction and graphic design can extend beyond the bounds of gameplay. The result is a more complete experience. It is a revolution in how we navigate games, and for all this, it should be commended. And though its issues may reflect problems with the gaming industry as a whole, that doesn't mean there isn't room for individual improvement. In many ways, Persona 5 feels like an experiment of just how far one can push the art direction of a game. Masayoshi Suto and his team deserve enormous credit for what they have achieved, but like most experiments, the focus is often on the thing itself rather than its wider implications. Going forward to Persona 6 and further Megami Tensei releases, Atlus needs to consider a wider player base rather than just those that have been able to play their games in the past. Persona 5 is an ideal representation of how to handle historical imagery and visual language in a non-alienating way. It shows us how to evoke an era for a modern audience to a level of competence that many recent releases fail to achieve. And when posed the question of whether video games are or can be art, Atlus demonstrates that there really is only one answer. But it also shows us the danger of our habit of generalizing other cultures into media-friendly denominators. Persona 5 is unlike other JRPGs. It is in fact one of the game's major selling points in the West, but perhaps we should acknowledge that there is more nuance to the term Japanese role-playing game than we've previously admitted. The success of Bong Joon-ho's Parasite ignited a greater interest among Westerners for Korean cinema, without recognition that Korean films are as varied and diverse in genre as our own. There is no one Korean movie, no one Japanese music. Stranger is a completely different show compared to Crash Landing on You, Baby Metal very different to Akuro. There may be elements that link them, but they are as distinct from one another as their Western counterparts. So then, perhaps there is no single way to classify Japanese role-playing games, no matter what may be the most visible and palatable thing in the West. Rather than simply a JRPG, Persona 5 is, like Noise, a representation of a dozen or more influences. It's not just about a chaotic soundscape engineered in the 1980s. Within it are the markers of a long and diverse cultural history. Much as punk and then noise were movements founded upon rebellion, they always needed something against which to rebel, a stable and continuous culture against which they can take shape as an interruptive force of creativity and change, for which they can be a subversive anti-hegemonic of social resistance. While Persona 5 is unique in how it presents itself, it owes much to the standards against which it pushes back. In reality, the decades of graphically unsophisticated art direction Persona 5 appears to leave behind is, in fact, one of the many influences that went into its conception. One can argue that, as it chafes against the clichés of its genre, it also embraces them, that it sculpts them into something completely distinct, yet somehow familiar. With this in mind, its resemblance to Japanese doesn't feel coincidental. Rather, it feels like any amalgamation of concepts and styles so significant can't help but reflect the movement's values, and that, as a result, every single part of Persona 5 is Noise.